Thank you. morning and welcome to this time of worship. I give thanks for everyone gathered here today to give thanks for, to grieve, and to celebrate Carl. I'm also thankful that we can be gathered here together to worship our God, in whom Carl trusted, and to worship in the same place where Carl worshiped for many years, and also for a short time where he served as an interim pastor, proclaiming and living out the good news and grace of Jesus Christ. So our worship service is printed in the bulletins. There's a few parts for you that are in bold. And then all of the hymns that we're singing today are found in your red hymnals. And all the hymns and scriptures were chosen by the family in honor of today. Following our time of worship, on behalf of the family, I invite you to the fellowship hall for a meal and a time together. We now are going to begin our worship with some words from scripture.
From the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 1. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. And from Romans 6. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, that we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. I'll invite you to please stand as you are able as we sing together our opening hymn, Now All the Vault of Heaven Resounds, hymn number 367. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Carl. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our time on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your aid so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I'll invite forward the Bishop of the Northwestern Minnesota Synod, Bishop Bill Tesh, forward to bring some greetings.
Thank you, Pastor Eric. Good morning. When the color is white and it's springtime, I can't resist. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. And therein lies our hope, both Carl's and ours, and why today is not only a day of mourning, but also a day of celebration for the victory that is ours in Jesus Christ. Penny, to you and your children, Rachel and Joel, and to your friends and family and all former parishioners of your beloved husband, father, grandfather, friend, and pastor, Carl Andersen. It's my honor to bring greetings and condolences from all of us in the Northwestern Minnesota Synod. All 80,000 of us in 220 worshiping communities across this Northwestern Minnesota Synod share with you the hope that we have an eternal life through the gift that is ours in Christ Jesus. Know that we are holding you in prayer now and will continue to do so in the days and months ahead. I didn't know Carl, Pastor Carl, well. But as a fellow Wisconsinite who also has spent most of his adult life living outside the borders of God's country, I feel a special affinity with him. And I'm reminded of the words of the writer of Hebrews, who spoke of faithful believers in Jesus who sojourned for most of their days outside of their homeland, when he wrote this: "People who speak like this show that they are looking for a homeland. Indeed, if they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have returned. Instead, they were looking for a better country. Not Minnesota, but a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them." For them, and for the likes of Carl and all of us as well. So know that you have our prayers and our hearts and in the days and months ahead. But what I think is most important for you, Penny and Rachel and Joel, to hear is a strong word of gratitude from me. Serving as a pastor is hard, and it often demands sacrifices. And faithful service would not be possible without faithful families who support pastors in their service. And oftentimes those sacrifices fall squarely and mostly on those families. And so, on behalf of all of us, Penny, Rachel, and Joel, and your families, thank you. Thank you for sharing Carl with us, to know and to love, as a pastor of this church and a servant of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Reverend Carl Edwin Andersen passed away on February 29th, 2024. Carl was born in Frederic, Wisconsin on November 12, 1946, to Charlotte and Reverend Leo L.M. Andersen. Carl lived his early life in Luck and Racine, Wisconsin. During these years, he and his two siblings enjoyed summers visiting their maternal grandmother on Washington Island, Wisconsin, making all kinds of wonderful memories and certainly plenty of mischief. family moved to Norwalk, California in 1958, where Carl would later graduate from high school. Carl attended California Lutheran College in Thousand Oaks, California, majoring in music. At CLC, he met the young woman who would become his bride, Penny Thilberg Berkeley. The two noticed each other while participating in the college's music ensembles. They shared a love for music, as well as identities as PKs, or pastor's kids. Romance bloomed, and a true partnership was born. Carl, who declared throughout childhood that he would never become a pastor like his father, nevertheless heard God's call in 1967. Carl and Penny were married in California on August 8, 1970. And they began their life together in married student housing at Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota. Carl was ordained as a pastor of the American Lutheran Church in 1972. And while he had hoped to begin his ministry back in California, God had other plans. Carl's first call was to Purley, a two-point parish in northwest Minnesota. The community warmly embraced the young couple in their early years of marriage and in the welcome of their first child, Rachel, born in May of 1977. The family moved to Thief River Falls in 1979, where Carl served as an associate pastor at Trinity Lutheran Church. While there, they welcomed their second child, Joel, in May of 1981. That fall, Carl was called to serve the Fisher Bigland Lutheran Parish in Fisher, Minnesota, a call he faithfully fulfilled for the next 27 years. Carl's later ministry took place in Vining, Minnesota, and here at Calvary Lutheran in Perham, Minnesota. And he officially retired in 2014. Carl possessed many pastoral gifts. He was a prolific and reflective writer, crafting and delivering a fresh sermon nearly every week. His preaching was a beautiful balance of academic study and spirit-led faith. He served and guided his parishioners with a steady and gentle presence that made people feel seen and known. Carl's influence reached beyond the church walls. He served on boards for public schools and charitable organizations like Pathways Outdoor Ministry and Habitat for Humanity. Additionally, Carl supported numerous individuals through their 12th step at Glenmore Recovery Center in Crookston, Minnesota. Outside of work, Carl was a natural and curious tinkerer who could fix just about anything. He would often spend hours taking things apart, diagnosing problems, and usually putting them back together. Another love for Carl was music. A true songbird, he could be heard singing or whistling anywhere he went. Carl had a particular fondness for barbershop music. He enjoyed composing and arranging for his quartets, and in retirement, loved singing in the Heart of Lakes Harmony Barbershop Chorus. Carl also participated and starred in several community theater productions during his years living in Fisher, giving performances that will remain in family lore for years to come. Although generally quiet and understated in everyday life, there is no doubt that Carl loved an audience and always found great joy in performing. In 2009, Carl and Penny settled into their home on Paul Lake, near Perham, Minnesota, where they made many happy memories together and with family and friends. In July of 2023, Carl moved to Ecumen Memory Care Cottage in Detroit Lakes, Minnesota, where he remained until his death. His family is grateful to the staff of the cottage for the care and compassion they provided during the final months of his life. Carl is survived by his wife of 53 years, Penny Andersen, Perham, Minnesota, children Rachel and Ted Horan of Moorhead, Minnesota, and Joel and Heidi Loving Anderson, Plymouth, Minnesota, grandchildren Lydia and Jonah Horan and Kinley and Bryce Anderson, sister Martha and Paul Glansman of Elk Grove, California, brother Paul and Rosanna Anderson, San Diego, California, brother-in-law Jeffrey Thilberg in Mesquite, Nevada, sibling-in-law Aon Onbjorg, Tacoma, Washington, brother-in-law David Willett Thilberg of Hampton Bay, New York, and numerous nieces and nephews. Carl is preceded in death by his father and mother L.M. and Charlotte Andersen, mothers-in-law Ruth Berkeley and Doris Thilberg, fathers-in-law Ted Berkeley and George Thilberg, and brother-in-law Neil Thilberg. Blessed be his memory. At this time, I'll invite Carl's daughter Rachel forward to share some words.
Good morning. I'd like to first take a moment to introduce our family, many of whom have traveled a great distance to be here today. My dad's older sister, Marty, and my dad's niece, Tanya, and her husband, Jerry, my dad's nephew, Scott, and his children, Donovan, Cassie, and Rochelle, my dad's younger brother, Paul, Paul and his wife, Rosanna, my dad's nephew, Brian, his wife, Cassandra, and their boys, Landon and Weston, my dad's siblings-in-law, Eowyn and Jeff, and his niece, Grace. Finally, my dad's son, my brother, Joel. Sorry. His partner, Heidi, and their family, my sweet niece and nephews, Kinley, Bryce, and Oliver, my husband Ted, and my own children, Lydia, his first grandchild, and Jonah, and finally my mom, Penny, who's, I don't even think I can talk about how great she is, and how strong she's been, and how she's cared for him. Our family remembers Dad as a big brother, little brother, Uncle Carl, Dad, Pappy, love, partner, best friend. You may all remember him as Pastor Andersen or Pastor Carl. Or maybe you remember him as a partner in music making, or perhaps a really good friend. Maybe he's the dad of your good friend. So touching to see many of our friends here today who maybe never even met him. Or maybe some combination of all the above. On behalf of our entire family, those here and those who are not, we thank you all for making the effort to be here today as we celebrate the life of our dad. It's hard, but being together with you is really a great comfort. My dad was a very good writer, so much so that I'm uncertain whether I'm up to the task of composing a descriptive narrative worthy of its subject. But as a 40-something wife and working mom of teenagers, what I can do is make a list. I can make lists with the best of them. So here is a list, by no means exhaustive, of things that we love about my dad and memories that we hold dear. His whistling. Scoops, slides, vibrato. He took whistling to the next level. His gentle, generous, and caring nature. His patience, not so much with dogs, but definitely with every person that he ever encountered. His wit and playfulness, with a twinkle in his eye that could communicate what he was really thinking. His ability to surprise with a hilarious yet understated zinger that you probably never saw coming. This happened even in his cognitive decline, which we all found fascinating and, of course, very funny. His intelligence and sometimes his cluelessness. His face when he sang. His performances with his barbershop quartets, especially those with Reed and Brian and Ronnie. Leading Sunday school songs with his guitar and his Christmas program role of the great late potentate. his legendary performance as Harold Hill in The Music Man. Oh, what a time to be alive in the Andersen home. Until his very last months of life, even dementia couldn't undo the preparation he put into this role over 30 years ago. Did you ever take and try to find an ironclad lead for yourself from a three-rail billiard shot? Just try speaking that line out loud. It's very hard, and he, like, it was there. His willingness to help us with anything, from building bike ramps out of scrap wood to preparing college application essays to unloading the dishwasher. Ask and it shall be done. Cutting Joel's hair for over 18 years. He was really good with the clippers. I don't think you ever went to anybody else growing up. It was always Dad. Playing horse and shooting hoops in our driveway. Learning from him to play my first real song on the piano and singing The Rainbow Connection with him in the variety show. Learning from him how to mow the grass and remove the snow. Working with him on anything with an engine, dirt bikes, snowmobiles, four-wheelers. He enjoyed spending time together taking things apart, either out of necessity or just plain curiosity. Along with this, the required runs to town to pick up parts and repair manuals. It's a good time together. Fishing off of the ferry dock at Washington Island and his selfless attempt at filleting the fish his son caught but wouldn't dare touch. His determination to solve any problem that stuck in his craw. His stubbornness almost always paid off. The sound of the air popper late at night as he prepared to finally relax in front of the TV at the end of the day. He liked his popcorn. And it was always just when I was going to bed. I think that was strategic, maybe. Likewise, the sound of MASH and Star Trek reruns in our early years and Seinfeld reruns later on. Watching Star Trek The Next Generation together. His enjoyment of physical fitness, whether it was playing volleyball, working out at the UMC Fitness Center, squeezing his grip strengthener as he watched 60 Minutes, or performing rest area calisthenics on our family road trips. Along those lines, his strength. He was a really strong dude. Like, just very strong. Gym time with Dad, followed by Pizza Hut. He was often a pushover for us kids, and besides, what workout is complete without a book it pan pizza? The sound of the typewriter on Saturdays, or the keyboard later on, I suppose, as he composed his sermon. And now and then, the slam of his office door when we were playing too loudly. Followed by Mom's, let's go to town, kids. His preaching and his way with words. The way he was able to be both pensive and lighthearted. His voice as he spoke the benediction in worship. The sight of him walking from the garage to the house, carrying his communion kit. And his Bible, and maybe his gym bag when a workout was involved. Thanks to those of you who have shared your favorite memories of Dad with us today and in the past weeks. Your words lighten our load of grief, and they gladden our celebration of his life. And now may the peace that passes all understanding guard and keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus forever.
Time will remain seated as we sing together hymn number 763, My Life Flows On in Endless Song, or put another way, How Can I Keep from Singing? At this time, our service will continue with the reading of Scripture.
Penny and Rachel and Joel and families, our deepest sympathies. Carl was a friend of mine when he was a first year at the seminary, and we roomed across each other from Bachman Hall. And I remember Carl being just one of the best students and very diligent in Greek and just an outstanding young man, but he always had a little bit of sadness about him. And that was because he was missing you, Rachel. And I'm not Rachel, Penny. He was missing you, Penny. You weren't even there yet, but I never did get to meet you, Penny, until we moved to Crookston, because going on internship and then Carl on internship, we always missed each other. But when I had the privilege of being a pastor here at Thilberg for 10 years, and then moving up to Crookston in 1987, and I think we moved on October 1st or September 1st, and the phone rang, and it was Pastor Carl. And he said, Bill, would you like to join us for tech study at Fisher and Climax? And then a day or two later, I had a call from Pastor Priest at Fertile, and he said, Bill, would you like to join me for tech study in Fertile? Well, being a good Lutheran and not into decision theology, I said, well, why don't you join us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Crookston? And they did, and that tech study continued for 35 years. But Carl was a special friend, and we would cover for each other when I was gone or he was gone. We would do funerals for each other, and Carl was so talented, and I did see him in Music Man in a few other places. And what a great performance that was. And Bishop Tish, he was one of the best pastors in the whole Synod. Just outstanding. But the psalm that they chose is Psalm 84, verses 1 to 4. How lovely is thy dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yea, faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at thy altar. O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in thy house, ever singing thy praises. And today, Penny, I think of you and Carl singing praises to God together in your 53 years of marriage, and how you praise God together during your courtship at California Lutheran Church. And then I think of Pastor Carl today in heaven, singing praises to God with Martin Luther, John Wesley, King David, and a whole host of others. What a glorious event that must be, to be in heaven with Jesus, seeing him face to face. I think Carl's favorite psalm was Psalm 23, is that right? It was chosen, or one of them, but when I think of Psalm 23 and Carl, sometimes they call a pastor a shepherd. Carl was a very good shepherd. He was a very good pastor. And Carl also knew, in fact, I think in 2 weeks it's Good Shepherd Sunday, that Jesus is our good shepherd. Pastor Carl knew the Lord was his shepherd. And I think Pastor Carl would want all of us to know, he would want you to know that the Lord Jesus is your shepherd too. The 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. The Lord leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. The Lord leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for the Lord is with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The Lord prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. The Lord anoints my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Too soon, much too soon. I wouldn't try to top what you said, Rachel. Those are absolutely marvelous. But let me say it's a privilege to be here. Carl and Penny and my wife Marty and I have been friends for over 53 years. Don't take this the wrong way, we were newlyweds together at seminary that fall of 70. And we've been dear friends ever since. It was kind of a form of bonding. It's also fun to be on the same dais with a former student, Pastor Clapp. A couple of things that aren't in the description in the obituary are Rachel. As you may know, Carl loved singing. He loved barbershop quartets. But one of the quartets that he created were the Crooning Callers, which did weddings and all kinds of seminaries, and several other seminarians would join with him. I won't mention who that is at this point. And there's something that would never make it into an obituary, but it just shows the amazing diversity of Carl and his intellectual thought, his deep faith, and his silliness. You'll have to ask Penny what it was like to watch Carl imitate a Martian lizard. Now, I'm not about to tell you how he got to Mars and saw this lizard, but I have to tell you, it was hilarious. And he even repeated that with us one time visiting. We were at Concordia, and they were up in Fisher. And he still remembered. Actually, he could still get down on all fours and do it, which was amazing. I couldn't do it by that point, I can tell you that. But it's a deep pleasure. Carl, I was very privileged that Carl was willing to sing at my ordination. Even though I was ordained in Western North Dakota, they were living over here in Pearlie at the time. They drove all the way across the state to be a part of the ordination. It's always dangerous when you ask pastors to read scripture because you get many sermons. You know, so I'll keep mine short. It was a dear time, and you're all in our hearts and our prayers. And we have all been deeply privileged to call Carl friend, parent, spouse, family member, congregational leader. God bless you all for being here. Reading from Isaiah 43, starting with verse 1. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And then, secondly, from John 14, beginning with the first verse. Jesus says to his disciples and to us, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Gospel of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you for sharing those scriptures today. The first one we heard was from Psalm 84, and that's probably a less familiar psalm for many of us, but when Carl's family shared that with me and I read it, I thought, what a great psalm to read on this day where we honor Carl's life and we give thanks to our God for Carl. Pastor Rec read these words from Psalm 84. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise. Ever singing praise and for joy to the living God. As we heard today, and as people have talked with me about Carl, a constant theme that nearly every single person brought up was how Carl would burst into song, singing or whistling. Even right after his stroke, I remember him humming. As Penny shared with me and we heard today, outside of the church, music was the big thing in Carl's life. And as we heard earlier, he loved to perform, and he had this amazing memory for music, being able to remember extensive words to songs and also words to hymns, even in these later years. One person shared with me some memories of Carl, and I think this person put it so well. They said Carl had a joy in life. And I think we all experienced that joy in life in the ways he lived and gave of himself through the church, for his friends, for his community, and for you, his family. Rachel, you shared it so well, the ways he was so present and sharing of himself with your family. I also think of Carl's sense of humor. One person also talked about that twinkle in his eye, and she said, Carl would get this twinkle in his eye when he was about to spring something on you. And we still saw glimpses of that even after he'd moved into the cottage. Penny also shared with me a few driving mishaps that Carl had throughout his life. A couple involved a garage, or one involved a church youth trip, a school bus, and luggage going all over the busy highway. As Penny shared, the church would not let Carl live that one down. And I don't know for sure, I could be wrong. But I can imagine Carl had a good sense of humor about that, maybe not in the moment, but later he had some fun with that shared story. Carl found joy in life, and I would guess a joy in serving as well. He enjoyed people, being fully present with people. We heard about the ways he served with Habitat for Humanity or camping ministry, or he did a lot of fifth steps with people at Glenmore Treatment Center. I think what a powerful way to serve and be present with people right where they are. I only got to know Carl in these more recent years, and I especially remember a visit with him when he was in transitions soon after his stroke. He had a little confusion in that visit, but most of it was full of clarity. And when I reflected back on that visit, I realized that throughout it, even the parts where he had some confusion, he consistently spoke and named all that was most meaningful and important to him. He had some confusion about where he'd worshiped that morning, and at times it seemed like he thought he was at camp. But even in the midst of that, he spoke with such appreciation for worshiping with you as family and enjoying great music. And he identified his support for camping ministry. And in a time of great clarity, he spoke of concern for you, Penny, and how his illness impacted you. On that day, Carl struggled with some words due to the stroke, but when it came time to pray the Lord's Prayer, he prayed it flawlessly. And when I offered up some hymns that we could sing, as soon as I said, lead me, guide me, Carl broke into song, and I had to catch up to him so we could sing it together. And again, in spite of struggling with other words, he sang those words of faith perfectly, including these words. I am weak, and I need thy strength and power to help me over my weakest hour. Help me through the darkness thy face to see. Lead me, O Lord, lead me. I looked back on my notes from that visit and what I'd written, and I had concluded at that time that Carl is a lovely person, so gracious. Last summer, when Carl was in the hospital, y'all know much of his life was involved in public ministry. When he was in the hospital, his ministry of extending Jesus' grace continued to come through. I'd come in the afternoon, and Penny shared that right after lunch, for anyone who came into his room, nurses, probably food service workers, others, Carl thought he was serving communion, and he was blessing everyone. And I think even in that, the way Carl sought to live, it points us to our Lord Jesus Christ, to Jesus who also seeks to bless everyone, to extend grace and welcome to people regardless of their brokenness or their struggles. We heard Psalm 23 today, that the Lord is our shepherd, who leads us and guides us and refreshes us. Jesus, too, calls himself the Good Shepherd. And he says that he knows his own sheep, his own people by name, and they know his voice, and they follow him. And he promises that no one can snatch them out of his hand. We trust today that Carl remains held in the care of his Good Shepherd, of our Lord Jesus Christ, just as Jesus continues to hold each of us in his care as well. Until that final day when Jesus will come to earth again, and God will create a new heaven and a new earth and make all things whole and well. And in that day, we are promised that Jesus will gather us together with Carl and all those faithful ones who've gone before us, gather us together, singing praises to our God in joy forever. Amen. In a few moments, we're going to sing our next hymn, Lord Jesus, You Shall Be My Song. And as we sing, I want to invite you to pay special attention to the words, as I think they describe a lot of the ways that Carl lived his faith and his life. And may these words also be a prayer for our lives. So please stand as we sing this hymn. It's number 808 in the red hymnals.
This time I'll invite us to join together confessing our faith in God using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As we continue with a time of prayer, each of our prayer petitions will conclude with the words, Lord, in your mercy, and I'll invite you to respond. Hear our prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have formed your chosen people into one communion, the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, grant to all of us who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all our sorrow on you, we may know the consolation of your love and may be strengthened for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, give us grace to entrust Carl to your never-failing love, which sustained him each and every day in this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and your life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life. We give you thanks because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of God to all. Make us certain that because Jesus lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall ever be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. At this time, I'll invite us to join together praying using the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. This time we'll continue with an offering of special music.
Goodbye, goodbye.
Say, open the gate, well, I can hardly wait.
we now get to commend Carl into God's care. Let us pray. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Carl. Acknowledge, we humbly ask you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all the saints in light. Amen. And I invite you to please stand as we sing our sending hymn. It's number 377. It's an Easter hymn.
At this time, I'll invite you to open your hearts and receive God's blessing. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all of our understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us go in peace.